Yeah.
Good morning, Rabotai. Welcome, everybody. Thursday, the fourth day of Shabbat, corresponding to January the 10th. Today is the Hilulah of the great Baba Sali, alav shalom. A great tzaddik that I believe the Kahal heard of him, and perhaps many of us and of you may have had merit of seeing the great rabbi, which lived in the city of Netivot until the last day of his life in this world. A person that was gifted with the power of blessing, the power of, the Gemara writes, Tzaddik Gozer HaKadosh Baruch Hu Mekayem, that many people were redeemed and saved and see miracles in the life due to the greatness of the and the prayers of Rabbi Sarah Hasidah Zechuto Yagena Aleno. But just to tell you one thing, they asked and they searched and they investigated where does the great power of the great rabbi came to be able to bless people and to be able to see things that people did not see. And they were given two answers. And this was discovered from early childhood. Shemirat HaLashon and Shemirat HaAinayim. The great rabbi was known for being very meticulous and protecting his eyes to see only things which are positive, holy, etc. And Shemirat HaLashon, and being careful how the rabbi spoke. Never uttering a bad word, God forbid, or something of Lashon Hara. And that gave the rabbi, according to what we learned in the rabbi's biography, the zechut of being literally one of the great tzaddikim of the past generation that has this gift. So be'ezat Hashem, the zechut of the Baba Sali, Rabbi Yisrael Abu Hasira, Yagin Aleinu, Be'al Kol Yisrael Achenu. Amen.
Amen.
As you see today, for those watching, we have Professor, we have now two microphones, one for the audio recording and one for the video live, watching live. But we don't display the brand of the new microphone because it did not pay royalties to sponsor the class. But if you're interested, we can put your name tag here on the audio mic, and then just to get you, you know, the proper labeling. There is something written here, but I'm going to cover it for business purposes. You see part of the word, that's it. So let's continue, just in case if you're asking why is the microphone reversed. On a different note, on a more serious note, amen. Beautiful Zohar of today, very meaningful and very practical, discussing, amen, the continuation of the topic of tefillin that we started to mention earlier in this week, connected to the final paragraphs of today's Perashat Bo, Kadeshli Kol Bechor, Vehayaki Ebiyacha. But additionally, we know very well that the Mizvah of Tefillin contains two more Perashiot, Shema Yisrael Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad, Behavtet Hashem Elokecha, and Vehaya in Shamoa. The Zohar says, and I gave this class in the earlier minyan today, so I'm going to speak from, you know, quicker than before, that both perashiyot, they deliver the same message, connection with Hashem, loving Hashem, bonding to Hashem through the mitzvot, but one perasha is all about Hashem's chesed, and the second perasha is creating an awareness of Hashem's Midat Hadin, Hashem, the attribute of judgment. Let's go quickly to the first perasha. Be'avta et Hashem Elokecha. Love Hashem. Bechol levavecha, bechol nafshecha. All beautiful, positive pesukim. In the second paragraph, that's Midat HaChesed. In the second paragraph, we come across Ve'haya in Shamoa Tishme'u. And then we have like a warning. Hishameru lachem, peniftei levavchem. The Torah is telling us, be careful of not separating from the ways of Hashem. And then we have a pasuk that according to the Sephardic tradition, we say it on an undertone. In the Sephardic tradition, this is the prevailing minhag, that this pasuk, we don't say it out loud. Why not? Because it's not a happy pasuk. It's a pasuk that tells us, listen, if you don't follow the ways of Hashem, Hashem keeps a distance from us. And if Hashem keeps a distance from us, where the beracha to the person comes from? That represents, the Zohar HaKadosh writes, midat hadin, representing Hashem's judgment. But the Zohar begins with an interesting question. The first pasuk of the Shema is Shema Israel, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. So I'm going to use today the whiteboard a few times because it's going to help us to understand better and faster what I'm saying. So when I say this pasuk, Shema Israel, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, how many times Hashem's name is found in this pasuk? Three times. Hashem Elokeinu Hashem. One, two, one. Hashem, numerical value 26. That's Hashem's name of mercy and compassion, etc. Then I have Elokeinu. Elokeinu comes from which word? Elohim, beautiful, that's 86. That is the name of Hashem related to judgment. And now we are able to understand something that we know, that in Egypt, how many years were we slaves?
200.
No, we lived in Egypt 210. Yeah. But how many years were we slaves? 86. 86, Elohim, judgment. That is a different shi'ur, not for today. I'm just only creating an awareness. And then what do we say? Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. Then we go back and we say Hashem is all merciful. Even though the Zohar explains that even though one of the lessons of Emunah is that we see a Kadosh Baruch Hu functioning sometimes or treating us Bemidat Hadin, with the concept of judgment, but at the end of the day, everything that happens to the person is for the good. And that's what the Gemara says, Nahumish Gamzu, Gamzu Letova. This is for good. Sometimes a person experiences a small medical condition, and while taking care of the small one, we prevent it of a big one. A person gets all frustrated. Oh, I wasted my day. I was in the hospital. They didn't find anything. They just found something small. Guess what? That finding something small prevented of something major. That's how a person, a Yehudi, needs to think. And that's why Nahumish Gamzu lives such a beautiful life, because he always saw the good. Rabbi Akiva, the student of Nahumish Gamzu, what does he say? If it happens, happens for a good reason. That perhaps we don't understand it. Beseder. Moshe Rabbeinu had the same question. I'm going to the end of the Zohar, and I'm going to come back. The Zohar today, at the end of today's class, quotes a pasuk from Perasha Ki Tisa. Perasha Ki Tisa is the Perasha that discusses the unfortunate tragedy of the sin of the Egel and the sin of the golden calf. And Moshe Rabbeinu begs Borei Olam for forgiveness, and Borei Olam forgives Am Israel. And I'm limited in what I'm saying because I don't want to carry myself. Did God really forgive us, or God diluted the invoice that we have? Imagine yourself, you owe someone $1 million. Okay? And what do you tell the person? Okay, pay me $500 a month. Till when? Till the day that Mashiach comes. Okay? It's not a lot, but at least it's something. Same thing happened in the sin of the golden calf. We deserved to pay the price for that sin. But Borei Olam said to Moshe Rabbeinu, I'm going to dilute, that's a word. I'm going to dilute the consequences of the sin of the golden calf Every generation will do a small down payment. That's an unbelievable chesed of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So when Borei Olam and Moshe Rabbeinu are negotiating a peace treaty for Am Israel, Moshe Rabbeinu finds an opportunity to ask God, Har eni na et kevodecha, show me your face. What does it mean, Har eni na et kevodecha? In plain English means, God, teach me, how do you judge the world? Why do we see sometimes a good person that's going through hardship, and we see a not a good person prospering? Shouldn't be the opposite? God says to Moshe Rabbeinu, Veraita et ahorai, ufanai lo yera'u. Moshe, you are judging based on the cover. You are judging based on what you see at this moment. Ufanai lo yera'u. But you did not see what happened before. Why this person owes money to that person? Or why that person caused suffering to another person? Sure, the limited amount of time that you're watching the movie of life, you think that he's guilty. But guess what? He owed him money from the previous life. So the Zohar HaKadosh quotes something that Rashi brings down. The Pasuk says, Veraita et ahorai, you will see only what you see now, meaning to say, you're looking at the back, ufanai lo yera'u, but you don't see my face. Rashi says, erhalo kesher shel tefillin. God showed Moshe Rabbeinu the knot of tefillin in the back. Obviously, we need to understand. Lo divra ha-Torah ela kilshon bene adam. When the Torah talks and the Mefarshim talk, they talk in a way that we are able to understand it. So the Zohar of today talks about this sentence that I just said. What does it mean that God showed Moshe Rabbeinu the back? What back? So it says, Rashi, Kesher shel tefillin, the knot of the tefillin. I'm going to draw a tefillin here quickly. We have first the bite that has the sheen. Then we have the lesuot, the straps, right? That go around the head of the person. At the end of the straps, we have kesher. We have a knot, okay? And this knot has two lesuot. It has two straps. One strap going down, and one strap going sideways. The Zohar HaKadosh explains that the shape of these straps from the tefillin, they actually represent the letter Dalet of Hashem's name. The letter Dalet. So you have the Shin on the tefillin of the head, the Dalet at the back of the tefillin, and the Yod at the tefillin of the hand. The knot that you have on the tefillin of the hand is the letter Yod. So I have Shin, Dalet, Yod. But Shin, Dalet, Yod, the same name of the mezuzah. But interesting enough, the Zohar explains that this knot of the tefillin, it looks like a letter Dalet. What's the numerical value of the letter Dalet in the Hebrew alphabet?
Four.
This represents the four letters of Hashem's name. Yod, Ke, Vav, Ke. Numerical value, 26. You see? Numerical value, 26. That's what Yod, Ke, Vav, Ke. I don't write Yod, Ke, Vav, Ke because if I write it, I cannot erase it. Because it's Hashem's name. That's why I'm not writing that. But the rest of the stuff that I'm writing, it's halachically not a problem. So, with this being said, you know what God is telling Moshe Rabbeinu? Veraita et ahorai. Look at the Yod, at the Dalet of the Tefillin. Yod Ke Vavke. Everything that I do is for a good reason. And that is the foundation of Parnasa, of Mehila, of Emunah. Emunah, what is the Emunah concept? I believe in Hashem. What do you believe? You believe that God exists? Most people do today, or the majority, I like to say. When Mashiach comes, everyone will believe, no exceptions. That's principle number one. But what is another principle number one? That nothing happens without Hashem's supervision. And you know what is again principle number one? That everything that happens is for a good reason. And now we are able to understand the Zohar's first question. The Zohar's first question was, when you say Shema Israel, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, why do you need to say three times Hashem's name? Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. Say Hashem Elokeinu. Why do you say Hashem Echad? Why do I need to make a sandwich with the third name of Hashem, Yod Keh Vav Keh? So the Zohar says that the Torah is teaching us that Hashem, mercy, compassion, benevolence, and kindness, and Elokeinu, judgment, din, punishment, etc., Hashem Echad, is also out of the Hesed of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The Zohar also today talks about four elements of life. Esh, Ruach, Maim, Afar. Esh, fire. Ruach, wind, air, spirit. Maim, water. Afar, dust. So we have the four components. This is how the Zohar writes in Bereshit, how Adam HaRishon was created. What did Hashem do? Hashem put these four components in the body of Adam HaRishon, and this is how Adam HaRishon was created. That's why another name of Adam HaRishon is what? Halato Shel HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The Hala of Hashem. Many wonderful Jewish ladies bake halot in honor of Shabbat. So how do you make challah? You take flour, yeast, that's the earth. Water, that's the water. You let it rise, that's the air. And you cook it, you bake it, that's the fire. So when we make challah, in a way, we are mimicking Hashem, how He created Adam HaRishon. But the Zohar adds one more component. The concept of the voice. When a person says Shema, there are a lot of halachot when it comes to the topic of saying Shema Israel. Obviously, some of the halachot, not all the halachot, but some of the halachot, the person must make sure to read the Keriat Shema, Bedikdukeha, Betevoteha, Ubeotioteha, the halacha says. You need to read the Shema precisely. Proper pronunciation. You should be able to listen to the words of the Shema specifically. Reading it with ta'amim. As we discussed the other day, when we were talking about the reading of the Shira, that whenever you sing the Siddur, for example, the beginning of the Ketoret, for example, Shema Israel, for example, Bayosha Az Yashir, that all these are Pesukim from the Torah, that we make the effort to read it with the proper ta'amim. And that's why the halacha discusses if a hazan who doesn't read with ta'amim, or a hazan who makes mistakes with the letters, instead of saying ayin, he makes it sound like aleph. Instead of say ayin, exactly. Instead of saying he, it's aleph. Okay. Instead of saying het, he says chav. Instead of saying chav, he says het. All these changes the meaning of the word of the tefillah. So we need to be very, very careful in pronouncing properly, because that can determine if the Mizvah Shema was done properly or not done properly, especially those that are Hazanim. Now, in the Shema, we have a halakha that says that when we say the word Echad, we need to elongate the word. How do we say Shema? There are many different ways how people cover their eyes when they say Shema. Sometimes people cover their eyes like this. But according to Kabbalistic books, how you should say Shema? Like this. Look at me. Look at my fingers. Shin, Dalet Yod, Shakai. When I do this motion, I am illustrating, so to speak, in a 3D mode, Hashem's name, Shin Dalet Yod, the same name of Hashem that's found on the mezuzah, which is a name of Hashem that is all about protection. That is the reason why we have this name on the mezuzah. Okay? Shin Dalet Yod. Now, it doesn't mean that if you do this, you're doing an avon. Has v'shalom. I'm giving you just a freebie, a free upgrade. Is that we discussed the other day. Remember when we learned the halakha about giving charity in Vayivarech David. And what did we mention? That the hand of the person is the letter He. The money is the letter Yod. The kupa, or the other hand, is the letter He. And the arm is the letter Vav. So by me giving charity with the right hand into the left, or from the right into the kupa, I'm illustrating Yod, Ke, Vav, Ke. You understand? So these are small things that have a great amount of value. This is a great deal, or in the world of business, a metzia, a bargain. Because not doing much, you're already giving charity. But now do it with a bit of kavana. Now you say Shema. Now you do it with an extra bonus. I'll tell you one more. I'm going to need your help for this. To make it more... Okay, let's make believe we have a mezuzah. Since I'm talking about the mezuzah, you have another black marker. This one is ready for retirement. Thank you so much. But Florida is a good place to retire. Less taxes than up north, I believe. Uh-huh. Right? Yeah. Masvud? Thank you. So this is a mezuzah. We have the shin at the back. I don't want to write Hashem's name. But at the bottom of the tefillin, of the mezuzah, many mezuzot have three words. If you look at these words, I didn't write them because are Kabbalistic names, we don't really understand them. We don't really understand them. But today, with God's help, we're going to explain what is the symbolic meaning of these three words of Hashem written in the back of the mezuzah. Just to clarify a halachic concept, if a mezuzah does not have these three words at the bottom, it does not render the mezuzah not kasher. All Ashkenazic mezuzot, to my limited knowledge, they have it. Sephardic mezuzot, many have them, and many don't have them. Let's talk about Hashem's name. Yod Ke Vav Ke. Okay? What is the letter after the letter Yod? What letter comes after the letter Yod? No, after. After the letter Yod. Come on, guys.
Yod.
Chaf. Excellent answer. So I have, after the letter Yod, which letter do I have? Chaf. Then I have the letter He. What letter is after the He? Vav. Beautiful. And what letter comes after the Vav? Zayin. And what letter Vav, what letter comes after the He? After the He? Vav. So I have this word. Chaf, Vav, Zayin, Vav. If you go back one letter, it gives you Yod, Ke, Vav, Ke. That's the code hinted in this word. Okay? Now, if you want me to go further, for me, this is an unbelievable thing. Because this makes up Chaf Vav, which number is Chaf Vav? 26. And Zayin Vav is 13. Equals 39. What is 39 equals to? Hashem Echad. God is one.
Wow.
Verstehst? Remember we discussed the other day, 39 in the Sisiot? Hashem Echad. Hashem Echad. That's letter word number one. But I have two more words. You can keep that. Let's go. After the letter Aleph, what letter comes?
Bet.
After the letter Mem, what letter comes? No, Lamed, Mem. Beautiful. After the letter He comes Vav. After the letter Yod comes Chaf. And after the letter Mem, it comes Nun. One second. I'm missing Mehila. I apologize. I'm missing one. Lamed Mem, this is He, this is Vav, Yod, Chaf, and Mem. Elokeinu Zayin. Zayin. Okay, so at the end of the other word, you're going to find this. Bet, Mem, Vav, Chav, Samech, Zayin. If I go back each one of these letters, it's going to give me the word Elokeinu. Elokeinu. Aleph, Bet, Lamed, Mem, He, Vav, Yod, Chav, Nun, Samech, Vav, Zayin. That's what you're going to find at the bottom of the mezuzah, at the back. And then I'm going to find, let me have the first one that I wrote. It's already gone with the wind. Okay. Same thing. Chav, Vav, Zayin, Vav. So you're going to find this, you're going to find this, and you're going to find this is Hashem Elokeinu Hashem. That is the hidden code in these three words in the bottom of the mezuzah. With this being said, then we can go back and ask the question of the Zohar. Why does it say Hashem Elokeinu Hashem? Why three times? Zohar explains, number one, this. That Hashem is good all around. We begin with Hashem's kindness. We begin with Hashem's mercy. Even though that in the middle I have judgment and challenges, at the end of the day, it's all part of the Hesed of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The Zohar says, you are right. You are right. But there is one more component. One more component. What is this component? The sound of the voice when we say Shema Israel. Every person knows the tune of Shema Israel. It doesn't matter Sephardic or Ashkenazic. In the Ashkenazic, how they say Shema Israel? Shema Israel, la 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 la. Shema Israel, Hashem Elokeinu. Right? I'm doing it good? Beautiful. Or Shema Israel, in the Sephardic tradition. Shema Israel, Amonai Elokeinu Amonai, Echad. Whatever, there is the fact of voice in the Shema. And the Zohar says, what has to do voice in the Shema? Why the voice is given so much attention? So I think that we can give a shi'ur on the topic of the voice, because, for example, kol ha-shofar, the sound of the shofar, kol Hashem b'nei elim, kol Hashem lahavot esh. Many times, if you look in the Mizmor le-David, the one that we say Friday night, in all of the synagogues of the world, מזמור לדוד אבול אמוני בנאלי אלה 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 כבוד מעוז. How many times the word call is found? Many times. So we understand, and the Zohar says, the concept of call, voice, is something very meaningful in the life of the Jew. And the question is, what does voice of the person represents? So the simple answer will be what? Call tefillah. Hakol. Call Yaakov, the voice of Tefillah, the voice of Torah learning, the voice of Tehillim, the proper wording. You know, we mentioned before Rabbi Israel Abu Hasira, alav shalom. If you were here in the beginning of the class, what did they say? That where did the great Tzaddik have the power to see things, have the power to say blessings? He's the famous Mekubal, the one barrel of Arak lasted for hours, irrelevant how many people came to serve. Imagine yourself, I'm gonna split my hot water with you. Okay? I take the cup, okay? And I'm gonna share it. I'm gonna split it in half. What happens now? My cup was full, now it's half. Guess what? The great rabbi used to put the bag under his cloth and used to pour. And the arak never ran out of it. Yeah. I'm sure you heard these stories.
Yeah.
And many berachot. Right, I saw pictures, I saw videos. Unbelievable. But again, where did he get such a power of blessing people and seeing miracles? Shemirat hapeh. Shemirat halashon. Shemirat ha'inayim. He was careful not to see things that are inappropriate or forbidden. And he was careful the way he spoke. Never uttered bad words. Never said, Chas v'shalom, lashon hara, or worst. Baruch, atta Adonai, Eloheinu melech ha'olam, shehakol nihiya v'tbaro.
Amen.
Excellent. Kol sason v'kol simcha, kol hatam v'kol kala, kol misalot hatanim mechupatam. That's what the Gemara discussed last week. The importance of going to weddings and making the hatan and kalla happy. Remember the Gemara that says, "Kol ha-mesameach hatan ve-kalla zocheh le-chamisha kolot." A person who makes the hatan and kalla happy has the zechut that the sound of the Torah penetrates in the mind of the person, and that's why I mentioned the pasuk before, "Hakol kol Yaakov." The famous pasuk that Ishaq Avinu said when it came to the beracha of Yaakov. What does Ishaq says? Hakol kol Yaakov. The voice sounds like the voice of Yaakov Avinu, but the hands, the hairiness of the hands, it leaks. It seems to be like Esav. So Ishaq Avinu couldn't understand. You are invoking God's name. You are saying to me, please and thank you. Are you okay? I said, please and thank you. It didn't exist in his vocabulary. Invoking Hashem's name. God made a miracle and he found the animal to provide for you. It never happened. So Ishaq Avinu couldn't understand. But I'm sure that the Kahal knows the famous derasha that we make. Hakol in Hebrew means voice. But the way it's written in the Sefer Torah is a very scary statement. The pasuk says, Hakol kol Yaakov. If you read it, the word Hakol kol, you can read two words. Hakol, which means voice, or we can read Hakal. The voice kol, written complete in the Sefer Torah, Kof Vav Lamed, means the voice of Yaakov. So as long as the voice of Yaakov is being heard, the voice of Torah, Tefillah, Tehillim, etc., so Esav doesn't have the strength to attack the Jewish people. But, God forbid, Hakal kol Yaakov, if the voice of Yaakov becomes weak, then Esav has the power to attack Am Israel. And that's a scary pasuk. is a very scary pasuk, meaning to say that every time we learn Torah, we are protecting Am Israel. And Chas v'Shalom, if we don't learn Torah, we're creating a breach in the security of Am Israel. And that's what the Zohar says, the importance of the call, not only on the concept of saying the Shema properly and listening to the words of the Shema, but to make sure that the sound of the Torah, sound of the Shofar, sound of the Tefillah, they don't disappear. Because if, God forbid, they are missing in action, we are waking up Esav with his animosity against Am Israel. Since I'm talking about this topic, I'm going to take a detour. Since the Zohar hints about it, I'm going to ride on one word that the Zohar brings. I said this back in the time of Hanukkah, but that was a very long time, and maybe people will benefit. So if you look here, you have it there? Beautiful. If you look at the menorah, look at my you can see them better. Can you see them?
Yes.
Yeah. Some call Mammon. What are these words mean? Or what exactly this do that fits into the Lamnaseah chapter 67 of the book of Tehillim? So I'm going to come down, stay there. Can you see the word Eretz on top of the word Tzom?
Yeah.
You see it? Beautiful.
Yeah.
Can you see the word Elokeinu?
Yes.
Yes. Can you see the word Kulam?
Yes.
Look at the bottom, at the last letters of each word. Eres is Sadi. Elokeinu, Vav. The Mem of Kulam. If you put these three words together, what word gives you? Som. Som means fasting, Teshuvah. What else do you have underneath? Kol. Exactly what the Zohar says. The concept of the sound of Torah, sound of Tefillah, Tehillim, proper speech. And what else do you have next to it?
Mammon.
Money. Okay? So I'm going to do this in writing. But I'm going to do it script. Because it's faster. So these three words. Some call Mammon. Represents three ways of serving Hashem, three pathways of Teshuvah, and the formula to reverse negative decrease in life. Tzom doesn't necessarily mean fasting, although the literal translation of Tzom means to fast, but this means Teshuvah, repentance. Then you have Kol, as I said before, the voice, prayer, positive speech, clean talk, no lashon hara, that's kol. And mammon is what?
Sedaka.
Money. Sedaka. Interesting enough, each one of these words equals the same number. 136. Look at the diagram there. 136 each one. Let's add them together. Gives me 408. 408, which is the numerical value of the word Zot. In the Torah, we find Bezot HaBeracha, Bezot Yavo Aharon, David HaMelech, Bezot Ani Boteach. What is the hint of all this Pesukim? That a way that a person can connect themselves to HaKadosh Baruch Hu is through these three steps. And that's what the Midrash Rabbah writes. Listen to the verse. Utshuvah, Utfilah, Uzdaka, Teshuvah, is tzom. Kol is tefila. And mamon is tzedakah. Utshuva utfila uzdaka ma'avirin et roah hagezera. The power of teshuva, the power of tefila, and the power of charity is able to reverse negative decrees against the person. Beautiful. One more. We pay a lot of attention to the tefillin of the head. What about the tefillin of the hand? We mentioned the shin of the head, the dalet of the head, but we're missing the yod. The yod is what? The yad. The yod is what? The yod of Yosef, asadik. The yod is what? The yod of Yesod. Let me put this in writing so you understand. We have the letter shin and dalet of the losh, and yod of the tefillin of the yad, the tefillin of the hand. And if you look at the knot of the tefillin of the hand, it always is sideways and must point towards the heart. But the Zohar says that the yod has a lot of meanings. Yod, yad, yod, Yosef, and yod of Yesod. Yesod. Yesod and Yosef are partners. Yosef is Yosef as a dig. And Yesod means foundation. The foundation of holiness of Yosef, the foundation of holiness of a Jew, is the concept of the Berit Milah. This is what Yosef as a dig represented. The personal level of holiness. And that's what the Zohar HaKadosh writes. The Zohar HaKadosh writes and it says that the concept of the purity of the hand is related to the purity of the Berit Milah. When I gave this class today in the morning, I had a question myself. How does the hand connect with the purity of the Berit Milah? The hand is the hand and the Milah is the Milah. So, thanks to you, all of you, something is traveling through my mind. Two connections. I'm not going to stand up, but use your imagination. The Milah and the hands of the person are very close to each other, physically close. Although the hands has the flexibility, Baruch Hashem, and the movement up and down, but if you stand up straight, the Milah and the hands are on the same parallel. That is one simple thing, obvious. But now comes the real thought. Yesterday, let me find it. Okay, I'm not going to read the full version. But remember yesterday's halakha, or 2 days ago halakha? The halakha says, concerning the purity and the holiness of the Berit Milah, that a person needs to be careful in not wasting zera. How does a man waste zera? How? How? Come on, answer me. Don't be shy. You're not being filmed. I'm the only one in the movie.
With the hand or
a hand. Hazako Baruch. Yeah. Listen to what he just answered. Excellent answer. With the hand. With the hand. The hands manually, God forbid, can help the person's milah to commit an avon. And now we are able to understand what the Zohar says. Why the yad, why the tefillin of the hand represents the holiness of the person? Because if the hand touches the Berit Milah in an inappropriate manner, We do the avon of Zera Lebatala. We cut the connector between Hashem and us. Imagine yourself, you come to me, Rabbi, I need a piece of string. Can I cut your wire? You have a long, you don't need a 3-footer. You can do with one. What's going to happen? You can say Kaddish on the machine. Why? Because I'm detached, I'm disconnected. And that's what the Zohar Kadosh says. When we put on the tefillin, it's not only about the actions, as I said yesterday, it's not only the emotions pointing the heart, it's not only the thought, the brain, but it's also the kedusha of the person. The level of holiness and irat shamayim that a person has. For this reason, and everything is divine providence, we're going to go from the Zohar to the halakha of today. And I apologize for going into overtime, but I think it's important. Number one, the halakha of today says, don't look at ladies. As he said before, not only the hands, looking too much is a problem. And that's why we talk about Shemirat Ha'inayim. I'm not saying that accidents don't happen. And I'm not saying that when you talk to your wife, look to the floor, because then you're going to have issues. But make sure that your eyes don't follow everyone walking around the circle, if you understand. And don't see in front of a store that displays not senyaut garments, like sometimes happens in the mall. Or don't go to a beach that is mixed gender. This is basic halakha. Number one, halakha says, don't touch between your legs. Open halakha, not gray. Clearly, it says avoid the contacts of your hands with the berit milah. Even when you need to go to the bathroom, you need to do it halachically correct. Meaning to say, do what you need to do for holiness, but no more than that. Why? God forbid. Because the person starts doing, that creates an hormonal reaction on the person, an adrenaline of blood, and God forbid, that can lead the person to the sin of Zera Levatala, of wasting Zera. And the Lacha goes even further, but I think that I gave you enough ammunition today of understanding that even something so common that we do every day of our life, like putting on tefillin, look how many fascinating secrets the Zohar of today is revealing to us, and this reinforces what I said yesterday. The importance of making sure that the tefillin are properly placed. The importance of making sure that the tefillin are kasher. Make sure, check them every few years. Buy them from a reliable source. And by Ezat Hashem, the tefillin will provide not only strong bonding with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, but one sentence that the Zohar says that I did not say because I saved that for dessert. The Pasuk writes, Bera'u kol ameh ha'ares, ki shem Hashem nikra alecha, ve'yareu min Mecca. All the nations of the world will see that God's name is upon you and will fear you. As the Gemara, what is this? Amar Rabbi Eliezer Gadol, elu tefillin shevarosh. In the zechut of us wearing tefillin, we are preventing attacks on the Jewish people. The goyim develop fear in the zechut of the tefillin. Why? Tefillin nikreu pe'er. Tefillin is the crown of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. As the Gemara writes, God, metaphorically speaking, also wears tefillin, the Gemara says. So as the Gemara, what's written in the tefillin? In our tefillin says, Shema Israel, Be'ahavta, Ve'haya. Okay. But what's written in the tefillin? Ata echad b'shimcha echad, umi ke'amecha Israel, goy echad ba'ares. The famous sentence that we say in Mincha, Shabbat afternoon, is in the parchment of God's tefillin that says, umi ke'amecha Israel, goy echad ba'ares. Who is like your nation Israel, the chosen nation of the world? obviously, when we talk about God's tefillin, it's all spiritual. In other words, what connects us with HaKadosh Baruch Hu? The love that we have to Hashem and the love that Hashem has for Am Israel. As the Pasuk writes, Koh Amar Hashem, Matzahem Bamidbar, Am Seri Deharev, the Pasuk in the Haftarah that says, Ahavat Olam, Ahavat Ne'uraich, God says to the Jewish people, you are my sweetheart. In the time of nothing, you follow me in the desert for 40 years. Be'eres lo zeru'a. Okay, my dear friends?
What's the halacha concerning going to the bathroom for number one in your hands?
What is the halacha?
Yes.
So he's asking, so how do you go to the bathroom?
Yes.
Excellent question. Go to the bathroom, manual, obviously, do what you need to do, and that's it. Don't touch too much. Make sure that the floor doesn't get wet. Make sure that the seat doesn't get wet. Make sure you don't get wet. Make sure that it goes where it's supposed to go. But don't do more than that. Don't start doing other things. That's all. If you need more pirushim, talk to me in private. Okay? But I think that the halacha is very clear. Excellent question. Let me wish everybody a lovely day. And we'll see each other by Ezat Hashem. Baruch Adonai Le'olam. Amen ve'amen. Rabbi Hananiah ben Akasha Omer.